السلام علیکم ورحمۃ اللہ وبرکاتہ.
وعلیکم السلام ورحمۃ اللہ وبرکاتہ.
نحمدہ ونصلی علی رسولہ الکریم، اما بعد، فاعوذ باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم، بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم. رب اشرح لی صدری ویسر لی امری واحلل عقدۃ من لسانی یفقہوا قولی. مسلم ہیروز، اینڈ دا ٹاک از نیور کمپلیٹ اینڈ وی ٹاک اباؤٹ دا ہیروز اور لیجنڈز till we talk about Aisha radhiyallahu anha. She is one of those dynamic, smart ladies. Every time we read about her, talk about her, we totally mesmerized. There is a hadith in which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked by Amr bin al-As one day, who is the most beloved of people to you? And while he was asking him that, they were like sitting in a public gathering or maybe among a couple of people. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam responded, Aisha. So he asked again, and from the men? And to which he replied, her father. So what we find out is that he had so much clarity about his emotions towards anyone, and in particular for Aisha radhiyallahu anha, he never hesitated to do that. Imagine a person in our society sitting with his whole family and saying that I really love and care about my wife. Even if he loves her and he makes those tall claims, he would be hesitant to do so in front of even his immediate family, let alone many people, so that it is documented for life. And secondly, we find out when Amr bin al-As radhiyallahu anhu asked who among the men, he didn't say Abu Bakr Siddiq, he didn't say my best friend. What did he say? Her father. Again, he had no hesitation showing his connection with Abu Bakr Siddiq through her. This is like an amazing thing that we find out about her. And he talks about this one of the dishes that was very famous and very popular in Arab world, Sariq. And he said that the precedence of Aisha over women is like this dish, which is over the, all the foods. So Aisha radhiyallahu anha, she was, if you look at her personality, she says that she opened her eyes in Islam. When she grew up, she saw her parents practicing religion. She saw them praying with the recitation of Quran, with the practices of Quran. And yes, also she saw the oppositions around, which were there from the society. She says that I never knew my parents without their having a religion. And at this very same time, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a frequent visitor over there in their house. So she always saw him coming in and going out. She was only 9 years of age when she got married to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet later told her that I saw you in my dream for 3 nights and the angels brought you to me on a cloth of silk. And they said, this is your wife, reveal her face, and I do, and it's you. And I said, if this is from Allah, then may it be. Now, in these times, it is very difficult for us to digest 9-year-old girl getting married. But we are very comfortable finding out 9-year-old girl having a Snapchat account, having an Instagram account, talking and chit-chatting to the guys, being friends, being into the fashion and peer pressure. We are not at all surprised if we find out world over 9-year-old girl having an affair and sometimes even landing into pregnancy. We come across such examples. We are not surprised now finding a 9-year-old girl having her periods. I mean, we have accepted everything except Aisha radhiyallahu anha being 9-year-old and getting married to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we keep going around in circles trying to either prove she wasn't 9 or justify, when in our own hearts we question ourselves repeatedly. 9-year-old? Seriously? How is this possible? And then we look around in the worldly scenario where there are NGOs and organizations and people who are raising slogans against young age marriages, And I have seen many girls making promise to themselves, I'm not going to marry young. Mom, I have a lot of plans in my life. This course, and then this course, and then this course, and then this ambition, and then I'll think about getting married. But yes, if someone wants to be my friend to learn Quran, maybe, you know, I can help someone. So let us try to understand this thought process. Where did it come from? And we need to keep addressing many messages that we'll be learning from the life of Aisha radhiyallahu anha here and then. If you look at the scenario in those times when Abu Bakr Siddiq radhiyallahu anhu converted to Islam and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was spreading the message of Islam, they were not received with a welcome. The people in Makkah, their focus was how we can trap the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and prove him wrong, or how we can label him with a title and tell people, see, we saw him as a Sadiq and Amin, but he's not. Have you ever thought about this thing? Why didn't they make this thing into an issue? He is marrying a 9-year-old. Nauzubillah, the kind of labels people are giving him in these times. He's marrying a child. We don't find a single narration, single incidence in Sirah where this question was raised in those times by his enemies. I'm talking about enemies who could have easily picked up on this, created a hype, and told people he's not a prophet. He just wants to have a lot of wives. And he wants to have, na'uzubillah, variety in wives. But nobody questioned it. Why? Because that was a norm of that society. For them, it wasn't such a big deal. Let's move on to Aisha radhiyallahu anha, because the moment we hear, okay, it was a norm of the society, we immediately land into some interior Punjab and interior Sindh and the feudal system and the tribal system, and we say, you know, the women, they are in the shackles of all these customs that the men have around in the society, and women are suffering at their hands. And when we look at those women, they are so miserable. They are actually miserable. There are cases of honor killing. These women, they have no right to utter a word, say anything. And they are trying to run away from those systems. They are trying to take refuge with different organizations or countries for that matter. But when we look at the life of Aisha radhiyallahu anha, she never did that. She could have easily gone to the leaders of Quraysh who were opposing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she could have asked them for protection. But she did not. In fact, she used to take pride in the fact that I was the only virgin wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She used to take pride that I was the only born Muslim wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we find out she never thought there was a generation gap between me and my husband. He fails to understand me. We don't click. I wish my father had given me a right to at least sit with him a couple of times and, you know, talk about this thing and see if we have some mental level. Nothing. She was so happy with him. For her, it wasn't the issue. So when people, they try to ask you, oh, you are a Quran student, tell me about Aisha radhiyallahu anha. Was she actually 9 years old when she got married? So you shouldn't be getting defensive. Yeah, let me explain, actually it's not like that. You just say, if she didn't have any problem marrying him and they were totally in love with each other and she was so productive all her life, why should it bother you and me? Let's talk about something more important than this marriage. We don't have to go beyond this certain line. It's like giving those people shut up call. That's it. They were happy. In Urdu we say, Mia Bibi Razi to kya karega Kazi. When they are happy, then why do we have to bother to that extent? So settle down your emotion the moment you read 9 years and you get into this mode of palpitations. Oh my God, how is this possible? This is possible. Plus, we need to find out that there are environments where 9-year-old girls are so mature. In our society as well, 9-year-old girl knows everything. She will give you so many accounts of her friends talking to the guys, she might even be doing it herself. She's watching everything on the movies, on the screens, just one touch away. She's very smart in many matters. So we should not be underestimating women from that perspective. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he did hijrah, till that time Aisha radhiyallahu anha lived with her parents. She talks about her account. She says, I was very young and I used to be playing with my friends, and once I was playing, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam walked in, and my friends, they used to hide away from him, and he asked, what are you doing, Aisha? And Aisha radhiyallahu anha told him, I'm playing with my horse. And he said, what kind of a horse is he? He has wings. It has wings. And she very smartly responded by saying that this is the horse of Sulaiman alayhi salam, and that is why it has wings. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would laugh on her accounts like that. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam migrated to Medina, and after a while Aisha radhiyallahu anha also moved over there, till the Battle of Badr she stayed with her parents. And then one day, she says, I was playing with my dolls and with my friends, and my mom called me and she got me all dressed up. She told me, now you're the bride of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and you're moving in with him. And she was totally fine about the whole idea. She didn't have any problem. Aisha radhiyallahu anha and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they had a very, very strong relationship. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to call her Aish. He used to call her Humaira. Humaira is the language of the people of Hijaz, where they say fair and blonde. So that means she was very pretty. She had fair looks. And he also used to call her Bint Siddiq. She was even sometimes called Siddiqa. So Abu Bakr Siddiq was the truthful, and the daughter also had the same title. When I read about Aisha radhiyallahu anha, I marvel, how come she never got offended? Because my parents are religious and that's why they are putting all these restrictions on me. They're more concerned about my marriage. Why do they always have to do everything that Islam says? Like in our time, when the parents are practicing, many a times we see kids taking a total 180 degree turn. They are put off by the parents' religion. They can't stand their mom going to a halaqa or dars. They have this resentment in their heart. They don't see the blessing of religion in the family. They make a comparison by looking at their friends who are allowed to do everything, can go anywhere, no restrictions in their families, and no compulsion of praying or being a part of a Quran course. No compulsions. And then the misery begins for these girls who say, I wish my mom wasn't so religious, and they forced me to cover myself, they forced me on all the list. Every time, we're sitting on a table to eat something, their lecture starts on do this and don't do that. Why are they loading me with all sermons? I just am so offended. Once I'm going to be out of this house, I'll decide for myself. I'll be my own person. She never did that. Do you ever wonder why? I often do. And I look at both perspectives. One is, did it have something to do with her parents, how they projected Islam? Because that's also an important aspect. Sometimes parents get so desperate that they force things on you just out of desperation, when they read all the virtues of doing a certain act which will lead you towards the path of Jannah. So they want the best for their kids. And that's why, rather than using their wisdom to explain those things to you, they come up with a forceful act, do this and do that. Why? Because they are desperate in that earning of reward. But at the very same time, I feel, if I look at from the other perspective, I'm pretty sure there are times when Aisha Rizalanha wanted to do something else, or she was doing something and her parents guided her, told her, which in these times we say, my mom always lectures me, my dad is always telling me to do this and that. For example, if it is Salah time, all the parents would tell you, pray, it's Salah time. For example, when the girl is grown up and she's looking so beautiful and all the men, wherever she goes around, they look at her. So the parents who have this sense of the message from Quran, they would always tell her, cover your satr, don't go around like that. Because they're desperate for their daughters, they are protective toward their daughter. This is what they're supposed to be doing. This is such a blessing in our life, which we fail to see. And if you read the Islamic history, and even in your own times, in your own class, there are going to be some of your friends who would say, I was always fine with my parents being spiritual. And there are going to be some who would say, I'm still offended. I am still not settled with the idea of being forced into a Quran course, or yes, I'm doing Quran course and I'm fine with it, but I'm not happy with my parents. In all these scenarios, you will feel the girl who has accepted her parents the way they are is more happy, more settled, more able to practice. And the one who cannot stand her parents for one thing or the other, her own perceptions, the parents might also be doing some mistakes in conveying things to her. But she's not going to be settled. She will never be happy with her life. She will never be happy with the verses of Quran. She will never be able to apply them properly. She will always be in one issue or the other. So life of Aisha Rizalanha tells us, be happy with your parents, be content with your parents. Imagine she is called Siddiqa. Her father is called Siddiq. She picked up the same traits as her parents had. Look at your own parents and write down at least three qualities they have. Do you think that you acknowledge those qualities not only for them but also by practicing them? If your parents pray tahajjud, at least you could pray 5 times a day properly. What happens at iftar time? What is the expectation of your mother and father? Be quiet and calm and focus on duas. And what are we focusing on? Chutneys and pakoras and chaat and filling up my plate and pulling away something in one direction or the other, or fighting with siblings over where to sit. These are small things, small gestures that we do for our families, our parents, to have a smooth running system at home. So look at your parents' traits and try to put them into practice. They're making so much effort for all of you. They're making so many duas for you. When you know they find you doing something which is not right, they cry. When it's about just you, they cry. They're not able to sleep. They're so worried. You wouldn't find a single person in life who would be worried like that for you, who would love you like that, who would care about you like that. So if your parents are strict, say Alhamdulillah. This is safeguarding me from many evils. And cherish your family system and work on your family system. Second important thing, as I said, the Prophet ﷺ used to call her by nice names. You know, they had the most romantic relationship. Rasulullah ﷺ loved Aisha Rizalanha. He used to give equal time to all the wives. But when it was about his connectivity, his clique, he said, there is no match than with Aisha. And he even used to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah, don't hold me accountable for how I feel about her in my heart. But physically I'm trying to do justice to all my wives. And we have so many beautiful stories and narrations of how they used to show love to each other. she was living in a room which was built just adjacent to the Masjid Nabawi. We find how Rasulullah used to take care of her. Once Rasulullah was on some campaign in the desert and Aisha Ziranha was with him. She lost a necklace which she had borrowed from her sister. Now for me, first time I read this story, I was like, she was going on an expedition in a desert and she borrowed a necklace from her sister. Amazing. Amazing. I mean, we would be going in our pajamas. In a desert, who's going to be there? Especially if I'm wearing hijab and my abaya. But she dressed up. And then again I found it amazing that what happened was she lost that necklace in the desert. And when she told the Prophet ﷺ, it was my sister and I have to give her back and I've lost it, he made all the people stand over there looking for that necklace. This is the kind of relationship they had. So much so that the Salatul Fajr time kept close and there was no water and they were not able to pray. Abu Bakr Siddiq Rizalan was so angry with his daughter and all the rest of the Sahaba also felt bad. We are missing the Salah because there is no water for wudu. And that was the time when the verses for Tayammum were revealed. And Aisha Rizalanha used to take pride in that. Women, they used to come to her for all sorts of problems. And you know, it is not very easy to disclose your very intimate details. We wouldn't do that. Would you like to come up over here and talk about your periods in detail? You don't want anyone to open your closet, just someone whom you don't know, and check out everything over there. Or if sometimes there's an auntie who's sitting with your mom and she says, yesterday my daughter made a cake or she did this thing and she reads this thing and you're feeling so embarrassed, you're like, mom, why did you have to give all these explanations, talk about all these things in front of strangers? She doesn't even know me. But Aisha Rizalanha revealed through those hadith narrations such close intimate details about her relationship with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and also the issues of the women, how they can be addressed, what are the solutions for them, and then the arguments sometimes she had with him. She even talked about the places where she had to say to the Prophet, I was wrong, you are right, I shouldn't have done it this way, I should have done it that way. So everything that was happening in her life behind the closed door, she made it public. Why? For a scandal? No. For the learning. Because she was with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and she lived over 50 years after his death. So she was there for such a long time educating people. The Sahaba, they used to keep coming to her whenever they were stuck in a situation, asking her, confirming with her a certain narration. Because she was so close to the Prophet that she was always there. We also find out she was very intelligent. And she had so much wisdom. And she would memorize things immediately. Who would do that? Who would be able to memorize things? Someone who has a focus. Someone who is not multitasking. Someone who is not engaged into useless time wasters. Someone who is not a procrastinator. Okay? So she was the one who was very focused in her attitude and in her learning. We find out that what a romantic relationship they had. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would sit with her and say, I know when you are content with me or when you are angry with me. And she said, how do you know that? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say, for when you're pleased with me, you say no by the Lord of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when you're angry with me, you say no by the Lord of Ibrahim alaihi salam. This is the way she used to give him this idea whether she's happy or not. When they will eat and drink something together, and she'll take a sip from her glass, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam will look at her, smile, take the glass in his hand, and turn it same place where she took a sip and he'll sip from there. And then they'll just laugh.